International conflict resolution seeks to find a common ground between all needs and interests of the parties involved. In the Democratic Republic of the Congo, there are two opposing forces over the issue of rape as a tool of war, those for and those against. However, the conflict goes beyond these positional statements and encompasses the needs and interests of many parties. Dennis Mukwege, the founder of the Panzai Hospital in the DRC, represents a social call to end violent rape. Through the Panzai Hospital, Mukwege has helped over 85,000 women receive necessary medical attention, while also utilizing this platform to call on the DRC and the United Nations to implement and practice laws forbidding the use of rape as a weapon of war. The government of the DRC and the United Nations both play primary roles in this conflict. As political entities, the introduction of laws could have significant impacts over the continuation or ending of violent rape. However, the conflict does not end with these two primary players. On a secondary level, the Great Lakes region of Rwanda, Uganda, and Burundi have all played a role in the Congolese conflict. These countries share borders and often see a diffusion of conflict. For instance, many will seek refuge in the DRC due to its low population density and close location. On a tertiary level, tribalism has played a major role in the DRC's history of war rape. For instance, in the Rwandan genocide, the Hutu tribe used rape as a tool of ethnic cleansing against the Tutsi tribe. One consequence of the Rwandan genocide is that many Tutsis sought refuge in the DRC. This Congolese Tutsi community later became a factor in the crisis of Congolese citizenship. The influx of new populations from the Great Lakes region plays a major role in the First and Second Congolese Wars. Ultimately, an ugly precedent of war rape has been utilized by all players in these conflicts, which has led to a lasting legacy for the DRC. This is the legacy Dennis Mukwege is seeking to change. The first step in conflict resolution is to explore the root causes of the conflict. In doing so, we discern the interest of all the players. Dennis Mukwege believes rape with extreme violence has social consequences. He claims that rape during war often leads to rape in civil life. In essence, Mukwege seeks to stop the diffusion of rape with extreme violence from wartime to peacetime. In addition, Mukwege highlights the psychological impact of rape on women in the DRC has led to an economic impact as women have become displaced from their communities due to shame. Finally, Mukwege argues that violent rape has lasting humanitarian impacts that exceed wartime. Women who have been raped during wartime may still live with sexually transmitted infections or unwanted pregnancies during peacetime. These children born from rape also suffer as they are neither recognized nor given legal status in the DRC. The United Nations also recognizes the social, economic, and humanitarian impacts of sexual war violence as a threat to international peace. This is evident in the adoption of UN Council Resolution 2106 in 2013. This condemns the use of sexual violence as a weapon of war and recognizes that sexual violence during wartime impedes on a country's ability to maintain peace and security. Although there is an international recognition of the impacts of sexual violence as a weapon of war, there has not been success in implementation of a law to prevent it. Mukwege criticizes the international community and the authorities of the DRC, claiming that the government is incapable of providing justice because law enforcement does not help to prosecute rapists. It is in the DRC's legal interest to allow rapists to escape prosecution as the culture of the DRC is largely patriarchal. By allowing sexual violence, it simultaneously reinforces the norms of patriarchy and establishes men in a position of power and control over women. In addition, there is a strong interest in using rape with extreme violence as a tool of ethnic cleansing. Through genital mutilation, a man can strip a woman of her ability to reproduce, thus not allowing her to extend her ethnicity to further generations. This was an interest of many parties during the Rwandan genocide, the First Congo War, and the Second Congo War. In addition, the lasting impact of sexual violence during wartime is economic and legal instability during peacetime. It was in the interest during the Congolese Wars to use sexual violence in order to displace women and hurt the opposing country's economy. In addition, it was in the interest to spread sexually transmitted infections in order to create health epidemics that would negatively impact the civilian life of an opposing country. Another interest of using sexual violence during wartime was that it often perpetuated a culture of violence and immorality that made the country unfit to maintain stability and peace after conflicts. These impacts make sexual violence an extremely effective weapon of war. This is proved by the Fragile State Index, which ranked the DRC as the sixth most unstable country in the world in 2018. These interests are better understood through analysis of the issues and scope of the conflict. The three main issues explored are humanitarian, legal, and economic issues. The humanitarian issues at play largely revolve around the psychological impacts of rape with extreme violence on women and how that perpetuates the gender gap in a highly patriarchal society. The gender gap is widened by rape because of the common practice of rape in public places, which changes the way children view their mothers and other women in their communities who are shamed in such a way. It makes the witnesses believe that violence against women is normal, which is seen in the common legal practices in the DRC to protect rapists. The legal issues focus largely on the morality of Congolese society that allows rape culture to continue even in civilian life. In a largely patriarchal society, rape and sexual violence are tolerated, as men are believed to have ultimate power and control over women. However, in Mukwege's humanitarian position, he believes this is an unjust extension of inequality. Finally, the last issue explored is the economic impacts of sexual violence as a weapon of war. Mukwege mentioned how public rape can lead women to flee from their communities and end the displacement of thousands. In his position, this is an economic impact, as it takes women away from their jobs and alters the composition of rural and urban communities. In addition, rape with extreme violence leads to a slow death of a population incapable of reproducing. This means that the population of the DRC will not be sustainable, carrying unintended economic impacts as well, as this means the depletion of a workforce. However, the opposing position views this as a benefit of sexual war violence, as it leaves a lasting wound on an opposing foe. Another key factor in conflict resolution is an understanding of power and resource dynamics. Mukwege claims that the Congolese people are ready for lasting peace and justice. However, implementation of this peace has yet to come to fruition. The Peace, Security, and Cooperation Framework Agreement in 2013 attempted to address the root causes of the conflict in the DRC and promote the peace process. However, in the last 5 years, the agreement has struggled with funding and finding durable solutions. The commitments made in the Peace, Security, and Cooperation Framework Agreement have yet to be accomplished and maintained. In addition, the international community has remained indifferent, which has allowed the conflict to continue for over 15 years. Although the Congolese people may be ready for peace, the international community has not stepped up enough yet to help promote and stabilize that. So, what is the solution? The solution for this conflict follows a BATNA, or best alternative to a negotiated agreement. In an attempt to speak to the needs and interests of Mukwege and many Congolese people, a solution would be an international pursuit of laws that forbid the use of sexual violence as a war crime. In addition, the international community must take steps to uphold those laws and ensure that perpetrators are held responsible. However, in pursuit of the best alternative, this may mean that the international community and the DRC can only pursue perpetrators after a certain date of enactment. This would mean that those who use sexual violence as a war crime in the past 15 years are not held accountable for their actions. Although this does not seem like justice, it would allow for the international community and the DRC to pursue future perpetrators. This could be beneficial as it stops the continuation of sexual war crimes. However, it also allows previous perpetrators to continue in necessary economic ventures and remain in their communities. The legacy of sexual violence has left a highly displaced population, with many women incapable to reproduce. If all sexual violence perpetrators were sent to prison, it would only displace the population more and take thousands of men from economic pursuits. This would only work to further wound the DRC's economy. On the other hand, it does prevent the continuation of sexual war crimes through a strong stance against future perpetrators, thus preventing the economic, societal, and humanitarian impacts previously discussed. This is not a full win for either side of the conflict. However, this does serve as the best alternative that can act as the beginning of peace building in the DRC. Furthermore, this could create legal precedents preventing sexual war crimes in other countries.